Again, good morning. We have a full day of talks. The morning session, we have four talks, starting with Ajit Kemvavi. Good. Emeritus Professor at IUCA, previous director of IUCA, Astronomy Department. He will be talking about applications of deep learning in astronomy and biology.
Good morning. I'm going to be talking about some very simple applications of deep learning to astronomy. There'll be two separate problems. One is finding bars in galaxies. Number two would be spectral classification. And then if time permits, I'll talk about a very simple application to biology. So much of what I would like to say as an introduction has been said yesterday, but nevertheless, just a few slides. But before that, I mean, we have got a group of people coming in and leaving the group and working together. A few of them were supposed to be here in this meeting, but they could not get visas in time. But they are beginning to get visas now, and they'll probably come next month. So then the first slide, of course, is that how does one use large data sets? And that is what we are supposed to be doing in astroinformatics. And we have seen yesterday through several talks that we are looking for patterns, correlations, classes, outliers, and meaning in the data, standard stuff. And then we also saw some in the talk, in the keynote address yesterday, they were talking about going back to domain knowledge and making it important again, which made me very happy. And then you need maths and statistics, of course. Then yesterday we had a session on visualization. And now today, and then machine learning and deep learning, and this is what I'll be considering today. So just to make a beginning, I mean, there are the different applications of machine learning which are not really in the domain of science, but I'll be using image recognition here in two cases, in the biology and astronomy, plus also I'll be using other things which are known as encoders for the spectral classification. Right, so to begin with the standard perceptron, so we have got any number of inputs coming in here. In the simplest case, for example, in the XY plane, we are trying to distinguish between blue points and red points which are in the plane, and if they are linearly separable, then we would have just two linear inputs here, a perceptron which combines them together, and the output which would be linear. So when you go to a more complicated kind of a problem, okay, then you could replace a single perceptron by multiple ones. Then you have got the input layer, you have got a hidden layer with which you don't interact directly, and there will be an output layer. And what is most important is to make the outputs non-linear, because otherwise you would forever be solving linear problems. So we can have the sigmoid function as a non-linearity, or the ReLU function, all of which is very well known. Typically this is what you would get. So if you had these points which could not be separated by just one straight line or a plane in higher dimensions, then you can use the nonlinear outputs to put any kind of curve here without prior modeling, which is the importance of neural networks. But as you go to more complex networks, then you see, you could have a large number of inputs. For example, if you try image recognition, if you have 1K by 1K image, then each pixel in the machine learning architecture would be treated as independent, and you'd have a million inputs here. So you'll require a large number of hidden layers, and then a large number of these connections, very large number of weights, so that the whole system becomes untenable. You'd find it very difficult to actually compute it. There'll be a lot of computing power which is required, and then there'll be grave danger of overfitting. So you need a different architecture, and therefore you go to deep learning. So the idea here would be that you work directly on the data rather than looking at features of the data. And for example, one of the problems that we had considered many years ago was to distinguish between stars and very small galaxies. So that was a novel problem at the time. And we looked at the point spread function, and then the point spread function of the stars, and then the profile of galaxies, and defined five parameters, and trained a network using a rather small number of galaxies and stars. And we are pretty successful in distinguishing between the two types. But what you do now is to just let the take in the image, work on the image directly using deep learning networks. So we can address very complex data which would be intractable from the conventional point of view. So you'd have the input layers, and then convolutional layers, then the downsizing layers, so that the classifier is working on features of the data which it determines itself. The weights of any particular features are not put in by hand, they're determined by the network itself. Right, so now a typical network, for example, the AlexNet, which we use in the Bard, identifying Bard galaxies. So we have got 5 convolutional layers, a total of 12 layers. You can see the architecture here. I'll come back to this in a moment. So this is just a nice picture, standard one, which shows that if you are trying to distinguish between a car and a truck and an airplane, I mean, this was mentioned yesterday. So when we put in the image, then the image here, after various convolution filters, you are emphasizing different features which will actually be used in the classification. So, and all this is of course automatic, we don't have to do much about it. So now the first problem that I'm going to consider is Bard detection in galaxies. So the idea is that if you have say a sample of 10,000 galaxies which you have taken from the Sloan survey, let us say, then we want to determine how many of those have got bars. Now for those of you who may not be familiar with this, now this is a standard galaxy seeing face on, and you've got the bulge, you've got the spiral arms, you've got the disk, but there is no linear feature here going across the galaxy. So you can see that here in these barred galaxies. So there you can clearly see a bar-like structure here, and the arms coming out from the end of the bars. And here's another spiral galaxy with bars, and this one is a lenticular galaxy. You wouldn't get these bars in elliptical galaxies because you need the disk. What the bars do is that they are breaking the symmetry in the disk, and then they allow matter to flow from the outside. It could be gas, it could be stars themselves, which flow in through the bar. And the bar can come up, it comes in because of the internal dynamics, can exist for a very long time, it can dissolve again. And the bars would be very important in bringing about galaxy evolution, because they are funneling matter from the outside to the inside. And we may want to see, for example, how many galaxies are bars, where the bars occur, or that they are environmentally induced, what kind of galaxies have bars, and so forth. So we want to build up large samples of barred galaxies. So normally you do that through visual inspection, which like always is very tiresome. And it's all right if you look at large samples where people have actually looked at bars and said that these are barred galaxies, you're really talking about a couple of thousand galaxies there. But if you want to do it for millions of galaxies, you clearly require an automated procedure. So the idea is to use deep learning to do that. So we begin with, like everybody else, a sample of galaxies from the Sloan survey, and this gives you all the details. They're not too far off, reasonably bright. And we use color composite images. Then these galaxies are cross-matched with catalogs of galaxies which are barred and unbarred galaxies. These are the catalogs that we used, so that you want to create a sample of thousands of galaxies. Because typically you'd require much larger samples to train these deep learning networks, which is one big disadvantage with them. And astonishingly, we don't have sufficiently large samples in astronomy, and so all kinds of tricks have to be used. Right, so here are these images, just sample images. Now these are unbarred and these are barred. So what this tells you is that in some cases, this may not be very visible to you, but the bar is very clear. But in other cases, the bar is not so clear, it may be more diffuse. Or there could be a combination of features inside which mimic a bar. Okay, so you really want to be as precise as possible. And that is what requires careful work, and otherwise it would be very straightforward. Yes, right. So there are about 2,000 each. You'll see the sample numbers coming in there. So you see what we have done here is we take a sample of HDHS galaxies which satisfy these conditions, and then we cross match them with the Nair and Abraham catalog and galaxy Zhu Willett. So these are our two catalogs for thing. Now so completely labeled. Right, so now you have got the network which I showed before, which is used for the training. So you have got 2,704 barred galaxies, 2,741 unbarred galaxies. Now you do the data augmentation by rotating the galaxies. Right? So we rotate the galaxy through a degree, so you get 360 times the sample, and which goes into the training. So when you pass it through the layers, so you'll see that there are the various convolutional filters. And just like in the case of the example with the cars, you'll find here that various features are being examined for it. And then when we train it, then part of the sample is kept back for the testing, and which is not used in the training. And you see that the training is fairly effective. Right here, meaning... You'll see that filter 14, filter 20, filter 32. Yeah. Yeah. So now, so you see here, you see that the code is pretty good, and you'll find that the 1100 barred, when you have the testing sample, you see that the wrong identification, the loss of data is pretty small. So if you look at it here, we define precision, which is correctly classified as barred upon total classified as barred. And then you've got the recall, and how many are you losing? So it's correctly classified as barred upon actual number of barred galaxies. So you see that it is in the 90s here, except in this case it's 86%. So one could tweak this, train it better, but we thought that we a pretty good result here. Now we try to generalize, we try to a different problem, is to try to find ring galaxies with rings in them. Now that's not going to be very easy because you've got the rings and then you've got the you've got the spiral arms which could be very tight, and then there are rings which are broken. So we have been working on that so far without success. I mean, let's say reasonable success is recently I heard a day ago that numbers are coming out all right. Because if you could do the ring galaxies, you've got the barred galaxies, then clearly you could just run it twice and get barred galaxies which have rings in them and so forth. Because it would be very difficult to train a single bout of training, single training sample to discover the different features. But then if you can do them one after the other, then one could ask questions like how many barred galaxies have rings in them. And there could be pretty interesting dynamical implications of having of these kind of features. Right, so now you can see here these are the incorrect classifications, observationally unbarred but classified as barred. So one tries to improve this all the time. And then here we take care to just shut off the block the central parts of it, and just to see whether bars are being detected and so forth. All right. Now the next problem is spectral classification. Another 15 minutes, 10 minutes, 10, yeah. Spectral classification of stars. A very simple thing here. So the idea is to go through the large collections of stars and try to find unusual stars. I mean, we had done that before using virtual observatory techniques. But I thought that if we classify a large number of stars, and then you find those stars which you, and collect those stars which cannot be properly classified, and then look at them more closely, and which could be strange stars in some way or the other. Right? So we want to make atlases of unusual stars. But we are still working at the classification, which proved to be a reasonably difficult problem. So, here are the spectra, which you see different kinds of absorption lines coming in, and the well-known MK classification. So these are the digital things here, spectra. So there are seven main classes, which are all done by this set of very dedicated women who are recently become famous in Harvard. And the seven main classes, there are 10 subclasses in each class. It doesn't mean that all the subclasses are uniformly populated. and some have very few stars. It's difficult to collect a good sample. And then there are five luminosity classes. Right, so, and then you start at the O, you have got high temperatures, and then as you go down the sequence, you get lower temperatures. So, this problem has been worked on for a long time, and people have used a just conventional neural network like this. Okay, so you have got 580 inputs, which are just the spectral points. Then there are 64 neurons, there are two layers, and then output layer. And we just modeled this on earlier work which had been done. And so now here, each point in the spectrum is being treated independently. Right, so we are not actually making use of any features in the spectrum. And there was pretty good result. So when we ran it here, you get an accuracy of 1.3 subclasses. Right, so if you, a star could be misclassified, and then you just see how many subclasses across it goes, and then the accuracy there is about 1.3 subclasses. But the idea is to try to apply deep learning to it, so that one addresses the subtle features in the spectra, and to try to see whether one can get more information, and which would help in collecting together stars which cannot be properly classified. The problem here is that you don't have enough. I would have thought there are tens and tens of thousands of stars with good classification. But if you go through the literature, you find that there are barely a couple of thousand which are available with very good spectral classification literature. Other people have private samples which they use and then they forget them. So if you look at the published work, you really find a relatively small number of stars. And so the problem is that you cannot, we could not, because this is a one-dimensional problem, and then we cannot do things like rotating the spectra or whatever. And then our attention was directed to autoencoders, which are very useful with one-dimensional data. Okay, so it could be a spectrum or it could be a time variation. So you see what autoencoders do is that you give it the spectrum here, and then they downsize the information which is there, and they encode it so that they're relatively it is compressed information now. And then you have the exact opposite setup here, so that you decode it again. And then you go from the encoding to the decoding. You've got the input spectrum. And then what you want is an identical output spectrum. So clearly, if you just give it one spectrum, you can do that very easily. You can compare the loss function, and then you optimize it. But the idea is that now you give it thousands and thousands of spectra, so that the encoding and decoding is done. And it is done in a way so that the loss function is the best possible. Okay, so that there is minimum loss of the data when you compare. So this is a unsupervised one. Okay, meaning that we are not telling the thing what kind of a spectrum it is, but that is being done internally. So the idea is that you you train an autoencoder like this using tens of thousands of Sloan spectra, and then you remove the second part and put a classifier there. Because now the weights are adjusted to understand spectra, you put a classifier and you get a pretty good success rate there. So you can call this as self-supervised, as they generate their own labels from the training data. Right? So autoencoders have been very useful. They're used in dimensional reduction, denoising, and so forth. And we are using them in a novel way. Now, so I've already gone through this. So this is the kind of architecture that we use. This is the training and test sample. So you've got the different libraries. So you see that you've got kind of numbers here. And then you've got the feature matrix with the train set B, and so forth. It's all been done in detail. And then you get here. So this is the kind of thing we get where the predicted classes against the observed classes. Now one has got to be careful here in putting on things like accuracy. Because if you look at the formal accuracy, it turns out to be very low. But what we've got to do, distinguish between a thing which is not properly classified, but could be just in the neighboring box. So it is better to say what is the RMS thing in the misclassification. And we find that we can come down to about 1.2 subclasses. So if you look at the best which has been done using, it has been done by Corinne Baylor-Jones and co-workers. So what they did was that they first used PCA to extract important features from the data, and then those features were put into a machine learning network. Okay, so they have got comparable accuracy here. So we expect better accuracy with the deep learning, but the problem there is that we have got a much smaller sample. We have got only a few thousand spectra which can go into the training, and also the signal to noise is limited. So our belief is that if we increase this, then we'll get much better accuracy. Okay, so alright, in the remaining few minutes, I'll quickly come down to the protein identification. So the idea here is that biologists like to find structures of these complex proteins, which may have thousands and thousands of subunits in them. Now the way you can use things like X-ray crystallography for that, but it doesn't work in the case of very large proteins. And so what they do is that they use electron electron microscopy. So the idea is that you take the protein and you embed it in a solution, in a substrate. And then when it's embedded there, what you are doing is that you get the electron micrograph from it. And then you can see these shaded things here. Now some of these are actually proteins, while most of the things are impurities. So what an experiment, what an experienced biologist can do, he or she could go through this one and say, this is a protein, and so forth. But that becomes, as you can see, a very tiresome process. So what is involved there, that you make a sample of the protein, you put it in a grid there, and then you take use the electron microscope to get an image. So you get 2D projections of proteins there, and then you identify the correct proteins, which will be a very small fraction of the impurities that they define there. And then those are used to make a 3D map. From there you get to a 3D model. So the idea is to try to make it automatic as far as possible. So therefore this process of identifying the proteins is not to be left to a human expert, but is to be done through deep learning. So you can see the problem here, that these are the encircled ones are, according to the human expert, the real proteins. Right, so what we do in the deep learning is that you take the raw file and then you enhance and label the image. Okay, then you use semantic segmentation to actually directly isolate the proteins, I'd say point out the proteins, and then you create the training and test data from it. Right, so there have been other attempts. This is not the first attempt to do that, and they typically, the accuracy which is obtained is sometimes high, sometimes not very high. And we are using this new method. So yesterday semantic segmentation was mentioned. Right, so what you are doing is that you are looking at the profiles of various objects, looking at all the pixels there, and finding the objects, coloring them so that you identify different kinds of objects. Precisely the same method was followed here, is that where we use various filters to enhance the image, and then you pass it through the semantic segmentation so that the proteins get differently colored. So you can see here, this is the original image, the enhanced image, and now you see that the proteins molecules are colored. So now the point is that now there's a relatively small sample, and then the biologist looks at this and then say, all right, you're successfully picked up 50% or 70% of the protein molecules. So that is the test. And once having got an adequate network for the data, then the protein picking becomes automatic. Right, so you can see the accuracies which are being reached here. So these are earlier methods, and we have got 93% accuracy. Some of the earlier methods give better accuracy. So we are fine tuning our networks. In some other cases, you don't reach the high accuracies, and that is because of the type of proteins, the kind of images you can get. And these are what are called technical biological problems, which determine the accuracy which can be reached. Thank you very much.